hands with black. Yield day to night. Comets importing change of times and states. Brandish your crystal tresses in the sky, and with them scourge the mad revolting stars that have consented unto Henry's death. Henry the Fifth, who famous to live long. England ne'er lost a king of so much worth.
England ne'er had a king until his time. Virtue he had, deserving to command. His brandished sword did blind men with his beams. His arms spread wider than a dragon's wings. He near lift up his hand, but conquered.
We mourn in black. Why mourn we not in black? Upon a wooden coffin we attend. Henry is dead and never shall revive.
He was a king, blessed of the King of Kings. The battles of the Lord of Hosts he fought. The church's prayers made him so prosperous.
The church! When is it? Ha! Had it not churchmen prayed, his bread of life had not so soon decayed. None do you like, but an effeminate prince, whom like a schoolboy you men overawe.
Gloucester, whatsoe'er we like, thou art protector and lookest to guide the prince and realm.
Cease! Cease these jars, and rest your minds in peace. Henry the Fifth, a ghost I advocate, prosper this realm. Keep it from civil broil. Combat with adverse planets in the heavens. A far more glorious star thy soul will make than Julius Caesar, or bright Cymbeline.
Away! Away, Guinness Femininity!
Guillaume, Chevalier, Blaise, Long, Paris, Guisa, Poitiers, all are quite lost. Dauphin Charles is crowned King of Lyon. The bastard of Orleans is with him joined. Renier, Duke of Anjou, will take his part.
How were they lost? What treachery was used?
No treachery, but want of men and money. Amongst the soldiers, this is muttered. And here you maintain several factions, and whilst the field is fashioned and fought, you are disputing at your generals.
If Henry were been called to life again, these news would make him once more yield the ghost.
My gracious lords, to add to your laments, I must inform you of a difficult fight. Lord Talbot
with
the French.
What? Would Lord Talbot or Kay, Mr. Tomb?
When Lord Talbot was overthrown, retiring from the siege of Orleans, he was encompassed and set upon.
What, is Talbot slain? Then will I slay myself for living idly here in pomp and ease. Bring me my steel coat, regent I am of France. Away with this disgraceful wailing rogue. An army am I mustered in my thoughts, wherewith already France is overrun.
Remember, lords, your oaths to Henry sworn. I had to quell the Dauphin utterly, or bring him in obedience to your yoke.
I do remember it. And here, take my leave to go about my preparation.
Out of the tower with all the haste I can, there to view the artillery and munition, and then will I proclaim young Henry king.
To Eltham will I, where the young king is, being ordained as special governor. For his safety there, I'll best devise.
Aye!
Each hath his place that buckler to protect.
I love that.
To be nothing of it.
Buckler, will I not be Jack out of office? The king from Eltham I intend to steal. Consider chief of third up at me.
Crop the flower to loose in your arms. Of England's coat one half is cut away.
Sir John Talbot been slain?
No leisure he had to enrain his men. He wanted pikes to set before his archers instead, whereof sharp stakes plucked out of hedges. They pitched in the ground confusedly to keep the horsemen off and break me in. More than 3 hours the fight continued. The valiant Talbot, above human thought, enacted wonders with his sword and lance. Hundreds he sent to hell, and none durst stand him.
Huzzah!
His soldiers find his undaunted spirit. A Talbot! A Talbot! Cried out a maid, and rushed into the bowels of the battle. A base walloon, to win the Dauphin's grace, thrust Talbot with the spear into the back.
I ask you, is the man slain? Talbot dead?
He lives, but is took prisoner.
This ransom, there is none but I shall pay. I'll hail the Dauphin headlong from his throne. His crown shall be the ransom of my friend!
Thank you.
roses from the tree are cropped, shall yield the other in the right opinion.
My Lord Warwick, it is well objected. If I have fewest, I subscribe in silence.
And, then, for the truth and plainness of the case, I pluck this pale and maiden blossom.
Huzzah!
Prick not thy finger as you pluck it off. Doesn't bleed you to paint your white rose red.
Now, sir, Muslim, where is your argument?
Here in my scabbard, meditating that you'll dye your white rose in a blood red.
Hand not thy rose a cake, Somerset.
Hath not thy rose a thorn?
Sharp and piercing to maintain his truth.
Well, I'll find friends to wear my bleeding roses.
I scorn thee and thy fashion, peevish boy.
Turn not thy scorns this way, Blancat.
Proud for my will, and scorn both him and thee.
I'll turn my part thereof into thy throat.
Away! Away, good Willem de la Pole. Be graced, the yeoman.
By God's will, thou wrongst him, Somerset.
His grandfather was Lionel, Duke of Clarence, third son, third Edward, a king of England.
Aye. Was not thy father, Richard, Earl of Cambridge, for treason, headed in our late king's days? And by his treason, stands not thou attainted, corrupted and exempt from ancient gentry, until thou be restored, thou art a yeoman.
My father was attached, not attainted, condemned to die for treason, but no traitor.
Aye.
And then I'll prove our better men than Somerset. Look to it well. Take it for well.
Thou shalt find us ready for thee, Skid. And knowest by these colors, for thy foes, for these my friends, in spite of thee, shall wear.
And by my soul, this pale and angry rose, as cognizance of my blood-drinking hate, will I forever and my faction wear, until it wither with me to my grave, or flourish to the height of my degree.
Aye! Well, go forward, then, and be choked with thy ambition.
Really bold. Farewell, ambitious Richard.
Come, son, that I have news to impart.
How I am brave, and must perforce endure it.
This blot that they object against your house should be wiped out in the next parliament. Call for the troops of Winchester and Gloucester. Now, if you be not dead for creating a York, I will not live to be accounted for. In the meantime, the signal of my love to me, but uncle, against proud Somerset and William Bold. Will I upon my party wear this robe?
Good Master Vernon, I am bound to you that you on my behalf would pluck a flower.
In your behalf, still what I
want
to say.
Thanks to you all. Come, let's to dinner.
It's well, of course, Dutchman! Stand in Winchester's name!
This quarrel betwixt Gloucester and Winchester, I dare say we'll drink blood another day.
And here I prophesy. This brawl today, thrown to this faction in the Temple Garden, shall send between this red rose and this white 1,000 souls to death every night.
All my flowers too. Be the fourth grandfather to this king. Oh,
execution was nothing less than bloody tyranny.
Silence, nephew. Be thou politic. Thy fiction is the house of Lancaster, and like a mountain not to be removed. Now thy uncle is removing Greeks as prisoners to their courts when they are cloyed. It's long continuance in a settled place. And so, farewell. Fair be all thy hope.
Spent a pilgrimage, and like a hermit overpassed thy days. Well, I will lock thy counsel in my breast. What I do imagine, let that rest. Here dies the dusky torch of Mortimer, choked with ambition of the meaner sort, and for those wrongs, those bitter injuries which Somerset hath offered to my house. I doubt not but with honor to redress, and therefore haste I to the Parliament, either to be restored to my blood, or make my ill the advantage of my good.
Hey, Uncle Gloucester, mitigate this strife.
uncle, kind Duke of Gloucester. How joyful am I made by this contract? Away, my masters, trouble us no more, but join in friendship as your lords have done.
Content, up to the surgeons, and I will see what visitors down the port.
Accept this scroll, most gracious sovereign, which in the right of Richard of Plantagenet.
Urge, my lord of Warwick, for sweet prince, you have great reason to do Richard right for those occasions I told your majesty.
And those occasions, uncle, were of course. Therefore, my loving lords, our pleasure is that Richard be restored to his blood.
Aye, let Richard be restored to his blood, and so may his father's wrongs be recompensed.
Aye.
As will the rest, so will it, Winchester. If Richard will be true, not that alone, but all the whole inheritance I give that doth belong unto the house of York, from whence you spring by lineal descent.
Thy humble servant vows obedience, and humble service to the point of death.
Stoop then, and set your knee against my foot. Rise, Richard, like a true Plantagenet, and rise, created princely duke of York.
And so thrive, Richard, as thy foes may fall, and as my duty springs. So perish they that grudge one thought against your majesty.
Welcome, high prince, the mighty Duke of York.
Perish base prince, ignoble Duke of York.
And now will it best avail your majesty to cross the seas and be crowned in France. The presence of a king engenders love among his subjects and loving countrymen, as it disanimates his enemies.
When Gloucester says the word, King Henry goes. For friendly counsel cuts off many foes.
Your ships are already in readiness.
Aye, we may march in England or in France, not seeing what is likely to ensue. This latent dissension grown betwixt the peers burns under feigned ashes of forged love and will at last break out into a flame. As festered members rot with mighty greed till bone and flesh and sinew fall away, so doth this base and envious discord breed. And now I fear that fatal prophecy that Henry born at Monmouth shall win all, and Henry born at Windsor should lose all, which is so plain that Exeter doth wish his days may finish ere that hapless time.
Shine upon the English side. And now we are victors upon us, Ismael. So wealthy, famished English like pale ghosts, faintly annoy us 1 hour in the bar.
So as some poor old shuns are fat bull beans, as they must be tied as youth, and as their proven dear
my word, for they are certain as a thousand.
Go, call her in. But first, to try your spear. Brandy, stand out as don't die in my place. Ah, I still have found you. Let thy looks be stirred. By this means shall we sound of what skill shall be.
By what means dost thou to be released?
The Duke of Burgundy had a prisoner. For him was I exchanged in ransom.
Well, how would thou handle being prisoner?
Ha! With scoffs and scorns and contumelious taunts, in open marketplace produced they me, to be a public spectacle to all. Here, said they, is the terror of the fringe, the scarecrow that he finds our children so. Then broke I from the officers that led me, and with my nails dig stones out of the ground to hurl at the beholders of my shame. My grisly countenance made others fly. None durst come near for fear of sudden death. So great fear of my name amongst them was spread that they supposed I could rend bars of steel. What stir is this? What tumults in the heavens? Whence cometh this alarm in the noise?
The holy prophet is new risen up.
Fear me. See, thou will do me some wondrous feats.
And yet, the thou that thinkest to beguile me, where is the dog back? Come from behind. I know thee well, though never seen before. Be not amazed, there's nothing hid from me. In private will I talk with thee apart. Stand back, you lords, and give us leave a while.
it. Stop it.
Celebrate the joy God has given us.
All France will be replete with mirth and joy when they shall learn how we are blessed in men.
Ah, it is a joan, and that we by whose day is won, for which I will divide my crown with her. And all the priests and friars in my realm shall in procession sing her endless praise. Ah, no longer on Saint-Denis will we cry, but joan de Poussin shall be France's sage. Come, come in and let us banquet royally on this golden day of victory.
Contrived by art and baleful sorcery.
Who's that Pucelle, in the terms of pure?
A maid, they say.
A maid, if he's so martial?
Come out of France! There, much he wrongs his fame. He's sparing of his own arms fortitude to join with witches and the help of hell!
Well, let them practice and converse with spirits. God is our fortress, in whose conquering name let us resolve to scale their flinty bulwarks.
Ascend the brave Talbot. We will follow thee.
St. George! His cross!
St. George! His cross!
Of the land!
Lackey of Somerset!
Minnow of York!
Darest thou maintain the formal words I'll spake?
Yes, sir, as well as you dare paint and give me barking of your saucy tongue against my lord the Duke of Somerset!
Sirrah, thy lord I honor as so, if witness take ye
out! Villain! Thou knowest the law of arms is such that whoso draws a sword to the present death, or else this blow, it broke thy dearest blood! Knowledge to his majesty, and pray my liberty to venge this wrong.
Well, miscreant, I'll be there as soon as you, and after meet you sooner than you would.
Parley with the Burgundy.
The princely
over tedious.
Look on my country. Look on fertile France and see the cities and the towns defaced by wasting ruin of the cruel foe, as looks the mother on her lowly babe when death doth close his tender dying eyes. See the pining malady of France. Behold the wounds, the most unnatural wounds which thou thyself hast given her woeful breast. Oh, turn thy edged sword another way. Strike those that hurt and hurt not those that help. One drop of blood drawn from thy country's bosom should grieve thee more than streams of foreign gore.
Neither she hath bewitched me with her words. When nature makes me suddenly relent.
Who joinst thou with but a lordly nation that will not trust thee but for profit's sake? See then, thou fight'st against thy countrymen, and joinst with them will be thy slaughtermen. Come, return. Return, thou wandering lord. Charles and the rest will take thee in their arms.
I am vanquished. These haughty words of hers have battered me like o'er-roaring cannon shot. Forgive me, country and sweet countrymen. My power and forces have been yours.
Turn, yeah! Frenchmen. Turn and turn again.
Welcome, brave duke. Thy friendship makes us fresh.
And doth beget new courage in our breasts.
So farewell, Talbot. I'll no longer trust thee.
Now, let us on, my lords, and join our powers, and seek how we may prejudice the foe.
Thank you.
Nails that have decided them.
There is my pledge. Accept it, Somerset.
No!
Cousins, both wait. York and Somerset, quiet yourselves, I pray, and be in peace.
Confirm it, so my honorable lord.
Confirm it, so! Confound it in your strength! And perish ye with your audacious prate. Place on shore, bastards! Are you not ashamed with this immodest, clamorous outrage to disturb and trouble the king and us? And you, my lords! Methinks you do not well to bear with their peevish objections. Let us persuade you to take a better course.
Come hither, you do with me combat. We charge you, as you love our faith, fight to forget this quarrel and the cause. And you, my lords, remember where we are, in France, amongst a fickle, wavering nation. If they perceive dissension in our looks, and that within ourselves we disagree, how will their grudging stomachs be provoked to willful disobedience and rebel? Besides, what infamy will there arise when foreign princes shall be certified that for a toy, a thing of no regard, King Henry's peers and chief nobility destroyed themselves and lost the realm of France? Oh, think upon the conquest of my father, my tender years, and let us not forgo for a trifle that which was bought with blood. Let me be umpire in the scarlet stripe. I see no reason, if I wear this rose, that anyone should therefore be suspicious I'm more inclined to Somerset than York. Both are my kinsmen, and I love them both. And therefore, as we thither came in peace, so let us still continue peace and love. Cousin of York, we institute your grace to be our regent in these parts of France. And good, my lord of Somerset, unite your troops of horsemen with his bands of foot, and like true subjects, sons of your progenitors, go cheerfully together and digest your angry choler on your enemies. Ourself, my lord protector, will retire to Calais, from thence to England, where we hope ere long to be presented with your victories.
My lord of York, I promise you the king prettily methought did play the orator.
And so he did. And yet I like it not, in that it wears the badge of Somerset.
Tut,
blame him not, that was but his fancy.
I dare presume, sweet prince, he thought no harm.
And if I wished he did?
But let it rest. Other affairs must now be managed.
Well, didst thou, Richard, to suppress thy voice? Or had the angry passions of thy heart pressed out?
Bastille Leon!
General of Bordeaux?
He was John Talbot, Randy calls you for. Son in arms, Harry, King of England!
Oh, Tyler!
Yes, he would. Open your city gates. Be humble to us. Call my sovereign yours, do him homage as obedient subjects, and I'll withdraw me and my bloody power. But if you frown upon this proffered peace, you tempt the fury of my three attendants.
Aye, Talbot.
Lead famine.
Aye.
Slaughter and steal.
Aye.
And fire.
Aye.
Fall me from this.
bands of steel and make the cowards stand aloof and vain. Sell every man his life as dear as mine, and they shall find dear of us, my friends. God and St. George, Talbot and England's right, prosper our colors in this dangerous fight!
Hang upon that villain Somerset, that first delays my promised supply of horsemen, never levied for this siege. He now lived Talbot doth expect my aid, and I am routed by a traitor villain!
Spartan, the rescue of noble Talbot, who now is driven with a waste of iron and edge about the spring of to mark down, warlike Duke, help stand well Talbot!
It is too late! I cannot send him now! No! This expedition was by York and Talbot too rashly plotted. The overdaring Talbot had sullied all his gloss of former honor. York sent him on to fight and die in shame. The Talbot dead, great York might bear the name.
Oh God! Let Somerset win Talbot's place. So should we save a valiant gentleman by forfeiting a traitor and a coward.
Send some succor to the distressed God.
He dies! We lose! I break my warlike word. We mourn, France smiles. We lose, they barely get. All wrong of this vile traitor, Somerset.
Away. Vexation almost stops my breath, exit a farewell. No more my fortune can, but curse the cause! I cannot aid the man!
Come now, good Exeter. Whither were you sent?
Whither, young lord? From Barton's old Lord Talbot, who, hemmed about with dire adversity, cries out for fresh air in York and Somerset.
York sent him on. York should have sent him aid.
And York is fast upon your grace, Exeter, swearing that you withhold his levied horse directed for this expedition.
York lies! He might have sent and had the horse. I owe him little duty and less love, and take foul scorn to fall on him by sending.
The fraud of England, not the force of France, hath now entrapped the noble minded Talbot. Never to England shall he bear his life, but dies, betrayed to fortune by your strife.
If he be dead, brave Talbot, then adieu.
His fame lives in the world!
His shame in you.
Yeah!
Thus, while the vulture of sedition feeds in the bosom of such great commanders, sleeping neglection doth betray the laws, the conquest of our scarce cold conqueror, that ever-living man of memory, Henry the Fifth. Whilst they each other cross, lives, honors, lands, and all hurry to loss.
A Talbot!
A Talbot!
Oh, young John Talbot! I did send for thee to tutor thee in the stratagems of war, that Talbot's name might be in thee revived. Now thou art come into a beast of death, a terrible and unavoided danger. Therefore, dear boy, mount on my swiftest horse, and I'll direct thee on how thou shalt escape by sudden flight. Come, dally not, be gone!
Is my name Talbot, and am I your son, and shall I fly?
Fly to revenge my death, if I be slain!
He that flies so will ne'er return again!
Shall all thy mother's folks lie in wait for thee?
Aye! Rather than all shame in mother's womb.
Part of thy father may be saved in thee.
No part of him but would be shamed in me.
Thou never hidest renown, nor canst not lose it.
Yes, your renowned name. Shall flight abuse it?
Thy father's charge shall clear thee from that stain.
You cannot witness for me being slain. If death be so apparent, then both fly.
And leave my followers here to fight and die. My age was never tainted with such shame.
And shall my youth be guilty of such blame? No more can I be severed from your sight than can yourself in twain divide. Then stay, go, do what you will, the like do I. For live I will not if my father die.
And here I take my leave of thee, fair son. Born to eclipse thy life this afternoon.
Come, side by side.
Together, live and die, and with soul, from France to heaven fly.
Then talk no more of flight. It is no boot. If son to Talbot, die at Talbot's foot.
Then follow thou thy desperate side of Crete. Thou Icarus, thy life. If thou wilt fight, fight by thy father's side, and commendable proved, let
let's die. Death, which left us here to scorn, anon from thy insulting purity. Two talbots, winged through the nether sky, and thy despite shall scape mortality. Soldiers! Talbot!
and means to give you battle presently.
Somewhat too sudden, sirs, this warning is. But we will presently provide for them.
I trust the ghost of Talbot is not there.
He is gone, my lord. You need not fear.
Of all base passions, fear is most accursed. Command the conquest, Charles. It shall be thine.
Then on, my lord. And France be fortunate. Hussein!
Lab. Fear him! Fear him who was crucified in man!
this knot of amity. The Earl of Armagnac, near Dick Charles, a man of great authority in France, proffers his only daughter to your grace in marriage with a large and sumptuous dowry.
Marriage, uncle? Alas, my years are young and bitter is my study and my books and wanton dalliance with a pair of more. Yet, call the ambassadors, and as you please, I shall be well content with any choice tends to God's glory and our country's weal.
I shall inform the Pope, the King, and the Earl, his liking of the lady's virtuous gifts, her beauty, and the value of her dower. You do intend that she shall be England's queen.
Bear her this jewel, pledge of my affection.
Lord Regent, I do greet your excellence with letters of permission from the King.
Well, no, my lord, the states of Christendom, moved with remorse by these outrageous broils, have earnestly implored a general peace betwixt our nation and the aspiring French.
Is all odds of him turned to this effect?
Aye.
After the slaughter of so many peers, so many captives, gentlemen and soldiers that in this quarrel have been overthrown and sold their bodies for their country's benefit. Shall we at last conclude a feminine peace?
Oh, Warwick, Warwick, I must see with grief the utter loss of all the realm of France.
Be patient, Your Honor. If we conclude a peace, it shall be with such strict and several covenants that the French shall gain little thereby. Well, now dismiss your arms when you please. Hang up your ensign. Let your drums be still, for here we entertain a solemn feast.
What? Is my Lord of Winchester installed and called unto a cardinal's degree? Then I perceive it will be verified Henry V did sometime prophesy. If once he come to be a cardinal, he'll make his cap co-equal with brown.
Perhaps by the French, and then I need not crave his courtesy.
Sweet madam, give me hearing in a cause.
I? Women have been captivate, ere now.
Madam, wherefore talk you so?
I cry you mercy, 'tis but quid pro quo.
Say, gentle princess, would you not suppose your bondage happy to be made a queen?
To be a queen in bondage is more vile than is a slave to base civility. Poor princess should be free.
And so shall you. Oh. I will undertake to make thee Henry's queen. I shall put a golden scepter in thy hand and set a precious crown upon thy head, if thou wilt condescend to be my
love. What?
Oh, his love.
I am unworthy to be Henry's wife.
Sweet madam. Oh, Renée. See, Renée, thy daughter. Prisoner.
To whom?
To me.
I am a soldier, and I have claim on fortune's finger.
Renée, consent. And for thy honor, give consent. Thy daughter shall be wedded to my king. Renée of France.
I give thee kingly thanks.
For this is in traffic of a king.
I do embrace thee, as I would embrace thee, Christian Prince, King Henry, were he here.
So farewell, Renée. Set this diamond safe in golden palaces as it comes. Oh, farewell, sweet maid. Oh, but hark you, Margaret. No princely commendation to my king.
Such commendations as becomes a maid. A virgin and his servant,
faithful. Words sweetly placed and modestly directed. But, madam, I must trouble you again. No loving token to his past.
Yes, my good lord. A pure, unspotted heart, yet the empty of love, I say you king.
And this we all. King and the realm.
love and honor Henry as your lord.
And otherwise will Henry dare with skill. Therefore, my lord protector, give consent that Margaret may be England's royal queen.
So should I give consent to flatter sin?
The heart.
You know, my lord, your grace is betrothed unto another lady of esteem.
Ha! A poor earl's daughter in unequal odds.
What I pray is Margaret more than that?
I guess, my lord, her father is a king. The king of Naples and Jerusalem.
Oh. Oh.
And of such great authority in France as his alliance.
We confirm our peace.
And so may the earl of Armagnac.
Besides his wealth, that warrant a liberal dower.
A dower, my lord? Disgrace that is so young. That he should be so abject, base, and poor, but to choose for wealth, and not for perfect love. Whom should we match with Henry, being a king? That Margaret, who is daughter to a king.
Whether it be through force of your report, my noble lord, or for that my tender youth was never yet attained with any passion of inflaming love, I cannot tell. But this I am assured. I feel such sharp dissension in my breast, such fierce alarms both of hope and fear, as I am sick with working of my thoughts. Go therefore, Summit, bring her to our presence.
My liege.
And you, good uncle, banish all offense. If you do censure me by what you were, not what you are, I know it will excuse this sudden execution of my will.
Father.
Uncle, how now?
Pardon me, gracious lord. Some sudden qualm hath struck at mine heart and dimmed mine eyes that I can read no further.
Uncle of Winchester, I pray, read on.
I trust. It is further agreed between them that the duchies of Anjou and Maine be released and delivered to the king, her father, and he be sent over of the king of England's own proper costs and charges without having any dowry.
My lord, they please us well. Lord Marcus, kneel down. We here create you first Duke of Suffolk, and gird thee with the sword. Cousin of York, we here discharge your grace from being regent in the parts of France till term of 18 months be full expired. We thank you all for this great favor done in entertainment of our princely queen. Come, let us in and see her coronation be performed.
Words bewitch your hearts. Be
of the land and the common profit of his country.
And so says York, for he has great reform.
Good, my lord of York, then let's make haste and look unto the main!
Unto the main! Ah, Warwick, Maine is lost. So York must sit and fret and bite his tongue, while his own lands are bargained for and sold. Anjou and Maine, both given to the French. The peers agreed, and Henry was well pleased to change two dukedoms for a duke's fair daughter. Old news for me, for I had hope of France, even as I have of fertile England's soil. The day will come when York shall claim his own, and therefore I will take the Neville's part, make a show of love to the proud Duke of Humphrey, and when I spy advantage, claim the crown. For that's the golden mark I seek to hit. Then, York, be still a while till time do serve. Watch thou and wake while others be asleep to pry into the secrets of the state. Till Henry circuit in the joys of love with his new bride and England's dear-born queen, and Humphrey with the peers be fallen at jars. Then will I raise aloft the milk-white rose, with whose sweet smell the air shall be perfumed. And in my standard bear the arm of York to grapple with the House of Lancaster, and force for force, I'll make him yield the crown. This bookish man hath pulled fair England down.
Gold cannot come amiss, wish she a devil. And yet,
I have gold flowers from another coast. I dare not say from the rich cardinal and the great and new mate Duke of Suffolk. Yet I do find it so. And thus I fear at last, Hume's knavery will be the Duchess' wreck, and their intention will be Humphrey's fall. Yeah, sort how it will. I shall have gold for all.
Can do most of all.
cannot do more in England than the Netherlands.
My Lord of Warwick is no simple peer.
Not all these lords do vex me half so much as that proud dame, the Lord Protector's wife. She sweeps it through the court with troops of ladies, more like an empress than Duke Humphrey's wife. Strangers in court do take her for the queen. Shall I not live to be avenged on her? Contemptuous, base-born callous that she is. She vaunted amongst her minions the other day. The very train of her worst-wearing gown was better worth than all my father's lands, till Suffolk gave two dukedoms for his daughter.
Madam, myself have lined a bush for her, and placed a choir of such enticing birds that she will like to listen to their lays and never mount to trouble you again. So let her rest. And listen, though we fancy not the cardinal, yet we must join with him and with the lords till we have brought you Humphrey in disgrace. So, one by one, we'll read them all at last. And you yourself shall steal them.
Richard shall live to make the Earl of Warwick the greatest man in England, but the king.
King! Gloucester King!
I doubt it not. See you well good for these good desserts.
What? Away with them! My lord! My lord! My lord!
I had them closed and kept asunder. Madam.
Oh!
myself to heaven I do appeal, how I have loved my king and commonweal. As for my wife, I know not how it stands. Noble she is, but if she hath forgot nobility and conversed with such as like to pitch, defile nobility, then I banish her my bed and company, and give her as a prey to law and shame that hath dishonored Gloucester's honest name. Mine eyes are full of tears, my heart of grief. I beseech your majesty, give me leave to go. Sorrow would solace, and mine age would ease.
Stay, Humphrey, Duke of Gloucester. Ere thou go, give up thy staff. Henry will to himself protector be, and God shall be my hope, my stay, my guide, and lantern to my feet. And go in peace, Humphrey, no less beloved than when thou wert protector to thy king.
My staff? Dear noble Henry, what is my staff? And as willingly the same I do resign as erst thy father Henry made it mine. And even as willingly at thy feet I leave it, as others would ambitiously receive it. Farewell, good king. When I am dead and gone, may honorable peace attend thy throne.
Why now? Is Henry king? And Margaret queen? This staff of Arthur's rot, here let it stand where it best fits to be, in Henry's hand.
Well, for this night we will toward London back again, to look into this business thoroughly, and call these foul offenders to their answers. And poise the cause in justice equal scales, whose beam stands sure, whose rightful cause prevails. Treason to our royal person, as is the sucking lamb or harmless dove.
interests in those territories are utterly bereft you. All is lost.
Cold news, Lord Somerset, but talks will be done.
All happiness unto my lord the king. Pardon my liege that I have stayed so long.
Nay, Gloucester, know that thou art come too soon. Unless thou wert more loyal than thou art, I do arrest you of high treason here.
Well, Suffolk Duke, thou shalt not see me blush. The purest spring is not so free from blood as I am clear from treason to my sovereign. Wherein am I guilty? Who can accuse me?
Tis thought, my lord, that you took bribes of France, and, being protector, stayed the soldier's pay, by means whereof his highness hath lost France.
It's but thought so. What are they that think it? I never robbed the soldiers of their pay, nor have one penny bribed from France. So help me God, as I have watched the night, aye, night by night, in studying good for England.
In your protectorship you did devise strange tortures for offenders, never heard of, that England was defamed by tyranny.
It is well known that whilst I was protector, pity was all the fault.
And these faults are easy, quickly answered. But mightier crimes are laid unto your charge, whereof you cannot easily purge yourself. I do arrest you in his highness's name.
My lord of Gloucester, tis my special hope that you will clear yourself from all suspect. My conscience tells me you are innocent.
Gracious lord, these are dangerous days. Virtue is choked with power and kitchen, and charity chased hence by rank of hand. I know they are complotters to have my life, and if my death would make this island happy, I would with all willingness expend it. But mine is made the prologue to their play. For thousands more that yet suspect no peril shall not subdue their plotted tragedy. Beaufort's red sparkling eyes blared his heart's malice, and Suffolk's cloudy brow his stormy hate. Aye, that dogged York, who reaches at the moon, whose overweening arm I have plucked back, by false accused doth level at my life.
Myself bewails good Gloucester's case for sad, unhelpful.
the king will labor still to save his life, the commons happily rise to save his life. Let us not stand on Willet's how to slay him.
Thrice, noble Suffolk, 'tis resolutely spoke.
No, not resolute, except so much were done. And to preserve my sovereign from his foe. Say but the word, and I will be his peace.
But I would have him dead, my lord of Suffolk, ere you can take two orders for a priest. Say you consent?
Here are my hands.
I'll provide his executioner.
This means word of rule.
And so say I.
And I. And now we three have spoken. It skills not greatly who impugns our doom.
Great lords, come hell into my common main. Don't civil Irish rebels on arms and temper clear with the blood of Englishmen. Send succor alone and stop the rage.
Oh, priest, it craves a quick expedient stop. My lord of York, try what your fortune is. To Ireland will you lead a band of men.
Let Somerset be sent as regent thither. 'Tis he that lucky ruler be employed.
Witness the fortune he hath had in France.
If York, with all his far-fed policies, had been regent there instead of me, he never would have stayed in France so long.
Show me one scar, charactered on thy skin. Such flesh preserved so whole, do seldom win.
Then, noble York, take thou this task in hand. Then, try what your hap is against the Irishman.
I will, my lord, so please his majesty.
Why, our authority is his consent.
I am content. Provide me soldiers.
I'll see it truly done, my lord of York.
Now York or never, steal thy fearful cause, and change this doubt to resolution.
Be that thou hopest to be, or what thou art, resign to death.
'Tis not worth the enjoying. Thank you. find no harbor than royal harbors. Faster than springtime showers comes thought on home, and not a thought but thinks on dignity. My brain, more busy than a laboring spider, weaves tedious snares to trap mine enemies. Well, noble Wales, is politically done to send me packing with a host of men. I fear me put more in the starboard snake, cherished in your breast, will sting your heart. 'Twas men I lacked, and you will give them me. I take it kindly, yet be well assured, you put sharp weapons in a madman's hands. Whilst I in Ireland nourish a mighty band, I will stir up in England some black storm, shall blow 10,000 souls to heaven or hell. John Cade of Ashford, to make commotion as full well he can. In Ireland have I seen this stubborn Cade oppose himself against a troop of Kerns, and fought so long, till that his thighs with darts were almost like a sharp-quilled porpoise's eye. This devil here shall be my substitute. By this I shall perceive the common's mind, how they affect the house and claim of York. Say he be taken, racked, and tortured. I know no pain they can inflict upon him will make him say, I moved him to those arms. Say that he thrive, as 'tis great like he will. Why then from Ireland come I with my strength, and reap the harvest which that rascal sowed. For Humphrey being dead, as he shall be, and Henry put him on, the next for me!
Like laments his death. What may I know
my life is death. Surely as my soul intends to live, I do believe that violent hands were laid upon the life of this thrice-famed duke.
What instances gives Lord Warwick for his vow?
But see, his face is black and full of blood. His eyeball stood further out than when he had lived, staring full ghastly like a strangled man. His hair upreared, his nostrils spread with struggling. His hands abroad displayed as one that grasped and tugged for life and was by strength subdued. Look, you see the sheets? His hair is sticking. It cannot be but that he was murdered here.
My Warwick, who should do the Duke to death? Myself and Beaufort had him in protection, and we, I hope, sir, commit no murder.
But both you were vowed his enemies, and you forsooth had the good Duke to keep.
That you belike suspect these noblemen as guilty in Duke Humphrey's time of death?
Madam, who finds the heifer dead and bleeding fresh, and sees fast by a butcher with an axe? One will suspect was he that made the slaughter.
Are you the butcher, Suffolk? Where's your knife?
Madam, be still. With reverence, may I say, for every word you speak in his behalf is slander to your royal dignity.
I wear no knife to slaughter sleeping men. Say if thou darest, proud lord of Warwickshire, that I am faulty in Duke Humphrey's death.
Dares not Warwick, if full Suffolk dare him, and that my sovereign's presence makes me mild. I would, false coward, send thy soul to hell, thou pernicious bloodsucker of sleeping men. Go!
Why, how now, lord? Your wrathful weapon strong, and our presence dare you be so bold?
Dread lord, come and send you word by me, unless Lord Suffolk straight be done to death, or banished for England's territories, they will by violence tear him from your palace. They say by him the good Duke Humphrey died. They say in him they fear your highness death, and mere instinct of love and loyalty makes them thus forward in his banishment.
Go, Exeter, and tell them all from me. I thank them for the tender loving care. And had I not been cited so by them, yet did I purpose as they do entreat, for sure my thoughts do hourly prophesy mischance unto my state by Suffolk's means. And therefore by his majesty I swear, whose far unworthy deputy I am, he shall not breathe infection in this air but 3 days longer on the pain of death. Ungentle queen, to call him gentle Suffolk. No more, I say, if thou dost plead for him, thou wilt but add increase unto my wrath. Had I but said, I would have kept my word. But when I swear, it is irrevocable. If, after 3 days' space, thou here be found on any ground that I am ruler of, the world shall not be ransom for thy life. Come, Warwick. Come, good Warwick. Go with me. I have
cease, gentle queen, these execrations.
Let thy Suffolk take his heavy meed.
Coward woman, soft-hearted wretch, hast thou no spirit to curse thine enemy?
God, a plague upon me. Wherefore should I curse thee? My tongue should stumble in thine earnest words. Even now, my burden break should I not curse them, who poison me their drink. God, worse than God,
the daintiest that they taste,
the softest touch,
as smart as lizard stings,
their music frightful as the serpent's hiss,
and boning screech owls make this consort full, all the foul terrors in dark-seated hell.
winter's night, standing naked on a mountain top. Mighty cold would never let grass grow. And think it but a moment, spirit.
Let me entreat thee, cease. Give me thy hand. That I may dote with my mortal tears. Nor let the rain of heaven wet this place to wash away my woeful monuments. So get thee gone. That I may know my grief, 'tis but surmise whilst thou art standing by. Go, speak not to me, even now be gone. Oh, come on, Jack. Even thus two friends condemned, embrace and kiss, and take 10,000 leaves, though there 100 times to part than to die. Yet now, farewell. Farewell, life with thee.
And thus is poor Suffolk 10 times banished. Once by the king! And 3 times thrice. Land I care for thou thence, for where thou art, there is the world itself, with every subtle pleasure in the world, and where thou art not, desolation.
Whither goes Exeter? What news, I prithee?
Signifying to his majesty, my brother Bulger is at the point of death. Suddenly, a grievous sickness took him. It makes him gasp and stare and catch the air, blaspheming God and cursing men on earth. Sometimes, he walks as if you come, his ghost were by his side. Sometimes he calls the king and whispers to his fellow as to him, the secrets of his overcharged soul.
Go. Go this happy message to the king.
If I depart from thee, I cannot live. I give thy sight to die. What were it else but like a pleasant slumber in thy land? To die by thee were but to die in jest. From thee to die were torture more than death. Oh, let me stay before what may befall.
To have thee with thy lips. France, sweet Suffolk, let me hear from thee, for wheresoe'er thou art in this world's glow, I'll have an iris that shall find thee out. Away.
I go.
And take my heart with thee.
A jewel. Locked in the woefulest cast that ever did contain a thing of worth. Even as a split box or something, this way fall I to death.
This way.
When you will. Die me not in his bed. Wherefore
God's good pleasure be. Lord Cardinal, if thou think'st on heaven's bliss, hold up thy hand, make signal of thy hope. He dies and makes no sign. God forgive me.
So bad a death argues a monstrous life.
Forbear to judge, for we are sinners.